Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber, Assistant Professor of History at the University of the District of Columbia. Welcome to another edition of UDC Forum. I am delighted to have one of my favorite artists as my guest. Dr. Synthia Saint James is a world-renowned multicultural visual artist, architectural designer, educator, and popular speaker. Her body of work also includes illustrating 17 children's books, 2 poetry books, and a cookbook. She is best known for the cover art of Terry McMillan's book, Waiting to Exhale, and for designing the first Kwanzaa stamp for the United States Postal Service, which was issued in 1997.
Wow.
You've done so much. It's just a joy to meet you. I remember when Waiting to Exhale came out.
Oh, yes.
And the cover was just absolutely fabulous. The book jacket has been framed in many homes, I'm sure. Tell us about that experience.
Oh, that was very unique. But first I must say that my first book cover was Alice Walker, a trilogy for a small Book of the Month Club. So she was actually the first person to use a piece of mine on a book. But when with Terry, it was like she actually owned the piece of art as a print, a reproduction, in her home. And she told me during the course of the time she was writing the book. And when the publisher's art director had art in mind and showed it to her, she decided she really didn't want it. So she got in touch with the gallery and called me directly and asked me if there's some way she could hook me up with the art director so that she could use that piece. And as they say, the rest is history, because it became an international book cover. And book covers in Japan, Germany, France, Spain, you name it, at least 8 countries.
Tell us about your work and when you first decided you were an artist.
I decided I was going to be an artist when I grew up, when I was 5. A little girl in the Bronx. And basically no prodigy whatsoever, but basically sitting around coloring like children do with my brothers and sisters, and probably thinking back that far, trying to see whose was the best or whatever.
Well, who did you see? What did you have any inspiration or role model?
No, it was just a very big thought that never went away. I would say that seriously considering it again, I mean, I continue to like draw. My mom could tell me more about that than I really realized how much I was doing. But she told me I was always drawing. And I don't, you know, of course, I don't remember all that. But I fell in love with the first movie, The Moulin Rouge, where José Ferrer played Toulouse-Lautrec, and that whole Impressionist period. And from that film, around that time, I made some decisions. So I was probably 12 or 13. And the decisions were that in my lifetime, I was going to make a living as an artist. Okay, most of the Impressionists didn't. Most of them died in their early 30s. I also decided I was going to live longer than 30. So now I'm 64, so I've done that. And just several things that made me decide, determine that in my lifetime I would be able to take care of myself.
As an artist, how were you trained? What did you go to artistic school or?
Actually, I'm self-taught. I've had some pointers from, someone that was so special. Prophet Jennings was an artist that passed away about 10 years ago. But they're about 30 plus years my senior when I was in my early 20s. And when I used to paint realistic portraits of people as well as wild and domestic animals, he gave me pointers on how to make the eyes come alive and what that special little brush strokes that you can do, where the eyes would follow you wherever you went. Yeah.
What was the first piece of art that you sold?
I was 20 years old, and I was in New York working as an accounts receivable clerk for a mortgage insurance company on Fifth Avenue. And one of the attorneys saw me always on payday run into the art store and bringing back art supplies. And he just one day said he'd like to commission me to do a piece for him. And so my first sale was that period in 1969 were abstracts primarily. So I created an abstract painting for him, and that's where my business started, because I bought the painting to deliver it to him. His name was Daniel Fishman, and I delivered it to him in the office, and then all my coworkers saw it. And from there, they started commissioning me to do pieces for them.
You said 1969, which was smack in the middle of the Black Arts Movement. Were you influenced by, were you following any artists?
You know, I really wasn't. I had been for a year upstate New York in Poughkeepsie going to Dutchess Community College, liberal arts, and came back to living in the city, not the city, but in the Bronx, and working. So I was kind of oblivious to an extent. I was still getting over Angela Davis and having dreams that I was Angela Davis and being angry. I was being very angry, and then when I look back on my life, I go like, but wow, there were certain things in the civil rights that you didn't even know you were doing and didn't intend to do. But I was in my high school, I was the first Black homecoming queen. And I was the first Black person to work at Grauman's Chinese Theater, because they needed to find somebody before they were boycotted. So they found me through someone that worked there, and it saved their, you know, the boycott.
Well, what did you think the obligation of the artist is? Because in that movement, you saw artists in the forefront, not only verbal artists, but visual artists. Do you think that the artist has an obligation to be aware of any social issues and then to operate in that arena?
You know what, I don't think it's so much of, I don't think it should be an obligation. I think if they feel that, and that's what they want, their intent, and that's what they want to do, then that's important for them to do it. I think it's very individual. I believe that whatever strides I've made as an artist, I've done it, but it hasn't been as obvious, you know, of some of the artwork of contemporaries that, you know, had the fists, like Bernie Casey,
right,
who I know and met in the early 70s. But it's still reflective of the same thing, the power to just say, I'm going to be out there and do this, and I'm going to exhibit and show my work and spread it around. So for me, I feel that my art is a gift, but also responsibility. And I use the responsibility more in aiding women and children and nonprofits, and that's my mission, which is involves all of that, but just in another way. It's not as obvious.
Yeah. Just talk a little bit more about that, because you wear many hats. You're in many arenas. Not only are you an artist, you're an educator. You've acted. You are a playwright. And you work with nonprofits, and you work with women and children. And tell us a little bit more about. Pick one and talk
Pick
about
it. Okay, I'll do like a short little thing here. When I moved back to Los Angeles from New York, where I was the accounts receivable clerk, but budding new artists that actually had commission work, the one mistake I made, and I don't know why I didn't think of this, but I left New York to move to Los Angeles, had several commissions unfulfilled, but never thought about the fact that I could paint it in Los Angeles and ship it back. So there was a little lapse period that happened. The first job I got by fluke was in the record business. I learned publicity and promotion. Green just went in, they hired me, and took me under their wing. And by the time I left there, I was assistant general manager. And what I had done, and this is in about a year and a half, I had learned promotion and publicity, which aids me till this day. So I was promoting singers and musicians. Well, now I was able to use every job I've had to help me on the left side, you know, promote my art, and often think about myself and write about myself in the third person. But a lot of skills came from that. During that whole journey, there was a period where I was doing some acting, which was great. I learned that I could. It was another challenge, but it wasn't a passion for me. So I got my big break. I had a national McDonald's ad. And I stayed home for 6 months and painted and became an inactive member of SAG. But I'm still a member of SAG. Right. And then art ended up on programs. The most recent thing that happened, I remember years ago, I thought, wouldn't it be great if one day I could be on a show and come in as myself? Got to do a TV pilot. I don't know if and when it's going to be picked up, but I actually, in January, for a new series called Basketball Wife, TV sitcom by Michael Jacque, he used 16 pieces of my art for the series. They've done 8 episodes, and I'm like in the final episode, but I come in as myself.
Wonderful. You know, I remember that maybe Bill Cosby's show sort of paved the way for that with the art that he had.
Well, but before him, Good Times.
Ah, Good Times.
Yeah,
of course,
Ernie Barnes. Ernie Barnes, and then, but for people to really start collecting art, it was definitely Bill Cosby's show.
You seem to have a unique handle on the marketing and the publicity for the art. Talk a little bit more about that, because we know that the artist has changed over the years. The starving artist is no longer in vogue. No one wants to starve for the art. You want to be able to create. You also want to be able to live.
Right.
So talk about the marketing piece.
Well, I definitely was a starving artist after the money wasn't coming in for the commercial. For years, but I always felt that and feel now, and teach and do workshops the business of art, because all artists, it doesn't matter what genre, we're not aware of copyrights, and we're not aware of work for hires, we're not really aware of things that we should be aware of. I believe the difference now is that most of us would think that we needed a gallery and an agent and all that. There's not as many galleries anymore. Yeah. We have the websites, we have all kind of high-tech ways of promoting ourselves without being pushy, because that doesn't work either. So there's a big difference in what I did, submitting things all over the place by paper and packages, and what we could do now electronically. Been teaching the business of art for several years. For little workshops, even for a Native American First Peoples Fund. So I finally sat down and wrote the book. So Living My Dream, an Artistic Approach to Marketing, which just tells my story, my mistakes, what I learned from them, short chapters at the end of the chapters, marketing tips. That's all in the back, recapped. And then for our spiritual and emotional side, I have 31 affirmations from my book, The I Wills According to Saint James.
Wow. You talked about high tech and technology. Now, different landscape completely when there's no really rare that you see an artist with a portfolio under the arm.
Right.
It's a flash drive, or they'll direct you to a website. Have you adapted to that? Are you invested in operating in that arena as well?
Yes, because now, most recently, I keep submitting myself to a lot of things. Mm. One of the most recent things is a metro system in Los Angeles, which is really kind of funny to me to think of a metro system in Los Angeles. But they're like the L in New York. They're elevated primarily. There are some like subways. There's canopies, and right now they're looking for artists to design canopies that was actually going to be fabricated like vinyl that would be adhered to it. And I said, well, I haven't done that, but I've, by just being someplace or something coming up, I have been able to do an airport, right, 2 feet by 8 inches by 150 feet that I actually designed. I was scared to death, and I thought they meant I needed to paint it, and then I learned a very important word, fabrication. Mm. So ceramic tileless fabricated this piece, 6 pieces, 25 feet each, that I did by hand on paper, rolled it up and sent it to him. And the only way that I was calm through this experience, because it was very new, I played Sade's Greatest Hits over and over again. And that's how I was able to do this to scale, because I drew it to scale.
So you're using the music as well to calm
yes.
you as you make the artistic work.
Yes, definitely.
Talk a little bit about the college tour that you're on.
Oh, what my mom loves about this is that when I was younger, she was trying so hard to help me, knowing that I wanted to be a painter. So one of her remedies was, maybe we just go through the college and then you can become an art teacher. So what's happened is, late in life, I've become an art teacher, or educator, which has been phenomenal. At first, it made me a little nervous to do it, but I then realized that all the students really want from me is for me to share experiences and things that may help them shortcuts, meaning not shortcuts, because not that typical word, but meaning, well, this was a mistake, because this is a good way to do it or a better way to try it.
Are you finding that it's important to, as you're teaching the mechanics of art, that you talk about the marketing piece to them early so they can be aware?
Yes. So far I've taught a couple of workshops, several workshops at colleges on the business of art. I've even one college, St. Augustine's University, even purchased 350 of my books and gave it to the English class, as well as to business majors. They had to purchase it to read. So that was another level. And before I forget, that was the first book that I self-published. And to my amazement, it was nominated for an Image Award for Outstanding Literary Educational, or what's it called? But it meant educational, but in that category. So that was just amazing to me. That was, being nominated was the award to me.
What do you find is the challenge for the young artists? What are some of the issues that they bring to class?
I think that in protectiveness, and I understand the protectiveness, they're really not given much encouragement to pursue their art. My recommendation is pursue the art, but learn something else as a backup. Have something else as a backup that can bring in the bread and butter.
Well, you have many other hats as a backup.
I have to have. Yes, yeah.
Talk about your work with the nonprofit groups, the women and children.
In the early 90s, several groups had wanted me to donate silent auction pieces or prints. And on one of my walks, as I've always walked, I came up with this idea, why don't I start creating and offering signature paintings to nonprofit organizations where that they'd pay a nonprofit price, mm-hmm. but they'd have something that they could print posters or limited edition prints and sell and make much more money. They'd have the ability to use it on merchandise, t-shirts, mm-hmm. mugs, their website, whatever they wanted to do, and I wasn't requesting any more royalties from it, more licensing fees from it. And I started doing that in 92. And I don't even remember how many to date I've done, but everything from 100 Black Men to United Way to Susan G. Komen for The Cure. And I've just got a commission from YWCA of Greater Los Angeles to do a piece for them. So that's like what you call a win-win.
You find that rewarding, I'm sure.
Oh, yes, because one of the pieces I did, and this is, I think this was a once-in-a-lifetime experience, a print from a piece I did for Sisters of Providence Hospital. The value of the remarque, which is just a print with me doing an original drawing at the bottom, was auctioned off to help one of the missions in Chile, and the piece was worth $1,200. And that night, when I was sitting on stage, it went for $50,000.
Oh.
Then the auctioneer auctioned off the other nine pieces. So the total was $126,000, and a corporation matched it. So $252,000 went to that mission that was burned down and had an earthquake. So that is a powerful, to think that a piece of my art could do that.
That is the kind of thing I was talking about when I was talking about the Black Arts Movement, mm-hmm. to make a difference and to be able to be a change agent. Mm-hmm. And so that, exactly what you're doing,
yes.
Even in a different arena, perhaps in a different way, but certainly was the whole thrust.
Yeah, but I'm also doing it for like Freedom School.
Okay, talk about Freedom School.
I did a piece for them last year. Some of these years go by so quick. Was that? I started it last year. I finished it early this year. And so they have like a 2x3 foot painting, and we've already done the prints. So they're selling the prints, bringing in more money for Freedom School, which is a nonprofit throughout the United States, Edelman's, from Edelman's organization here. But every school has to raise
Children's
money.
Children's Defense Fund.
Right. Every entity, wherever they are, has to raise the money to make this happen. So it's like a 6-week summer time for, they called them the young scholars.
Your work has such brilliant colors in it. Where does that come from?
I think it comes from heritage. Since I'm self-taught, I would say definitely my African, my Cherokee, and my Haitian heritage. Because I'm just drawn to bright colors, and that's
what
I
Some of it looks like Louise May Lou Jones's work.
A student mentioned that to me yesterday, and he said Louise Jones. I said maybe Louise Milo, and when I read about her about maybe 12 years ago, mm-hmm. I found that a lot of the places that had inspired her are a lot of the places that have inspired me. I wish I had gotten a chance to meet her.
That she was at Howard many years, and I missed her as well, but her work is there.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely fabulous. Now, you did the first Kwanzaa stamp
yes.
for the United States Postal Service. Tell us about that honor.
Oh, remind me to tell you about one other honor.
Okay.
I got a phone call, and I wondered how the U.S. Postal Service got my phone number, because a good little New York girl doesn't have her phone listed. So, come to find out that they had done research, and that year they did a Cinco de Mayo, a Hanukkah, and they wanted to do a Kwanzaa stamp. So they saw a cover of a book, not my book, but a cover I did for another author who also had written a Kwanzaa book. And that's how they found me and decided. So it was just straight up commission. It was not a competition. It was, so it was incredible. It was out of nowhere.
That's amazing, because every Kwanzaa now, everyone's looking for your stamp.
Right, and they're not there anymore.
I know.
But it was 32, 33, 34, 37. It had a long life.
Beautiful. Now, there's another honor you wanted me to remind
you. Oh, my God. To me, a couple of years ago, one of my biggest honors was to create a piece for Nelson Mandela's lifetime achievement. So for Africare. And it was presented here at one of the museums in D.C., who picked up the award was his daughter and his grandson. So it's called Madiba Mandela, and it's him surrounded by children and some of the, a lot of the Indibeli, all of just Kente and whatever, just the feeling of them surrounding and embracing him. So I still own the original, but what they were getting from me was a G-clay on canvas, which looks like an original, and it was framed brilliantly, and then it had lifetime achievement at the bottom, and that was presented to him. That was an honor.
Wow, certainly is. Who is an artist, if you were collecting work, whose work would you collect?
Well, you know what? I get to do it another kind of way. My best buddy artist is Charles Bibbs. We have done 8 collaborative paintings together, and so we share them. So I'm collecting them as we do this. Another dear friend of mine was Tina Allen. So I have a bronze from Tina, and she, for me, had chosen a piece of an oil painting that she wanted. Actually, they were Buddhist monks.
You said that a lot of the young artists don't get encouragement. Mm-hmm. How do you encourage them? What do you say to perhaps a young student who you're self-taught, who maybe is self-taught? Do you think they need to have formal training now? Is there a difference in this day and age?
Well, you know what? It could go either way, because there's a lot of artists that don't really need to go do the education. But in this day and age, it's important to have that diploma, that degree. So that's a big difference. My honorary degree was how much I had done in 40-something years. So it took me a little longer to get my degree. But as far as encouraging, I think it's that I always say that they should really look into their heart and see what they're saying, their inside. What's that voice inside them telling them? And so then a lot of times you have to block out what everyone else is saying, but still be realistic about where money comes from and that no one's going to bang your door down and discover you.
With the dissolution of a lot of galleries and the internet sort of replacing that, how do you see artists having the opportunity to show their work?
That's why they have to become more assertive and use all the tools that are out there. I listed in my workshop recently websites that are free to artists on a certain level, and if they want to pump it up, it's sometimes only $100 a year, like Fine Art America, you know, Absolute Arts, Black Art in America. You know, there's different venues that are free. Then with all of the Twitter and the Facebook and Tumblr and Google and on, there's so many ways for them to broadcast news about themselves and not feel shy to do that, because that's the way of the world now.
And so what you're teaching and what your book is talking about is the emphasis now, certainly the talent, but the talent is not enough. It has to be a knowledge of how to market, and that incorporates the internet.
Yes, and not to feel dependent or feel like you have to have an agent, a rep, or gallery to, like, in a sense, to baby us.
You have had some great honors, and you've had a lot of firsts. What are you looking forward to? What's on the horizon? What new things are energizing you?
Oh, God. Well, right now, I'm really excited about booking more colleges and universities for this tour that I've put together, with an emphasis on historically Black colleges and universities. Some coming up, a lot aren't confirmed, but possibilities. The one confirmed is Tennessee State, Harris Stowe in St. Louis. I'm talking with Hampton. God, there's so many. I mean, there's like Albany State University.
And there's so many young artists who need to have you there.
Because there's not much in there anymore to really talk. Here you've got a nice art department.
Yes.
But so many places don't.
I know. It's unfortunate. That's why it's important for artists to be able to share and to take it upon themselves to be educators, whether they started out that way or not.
Well, this is my mission.
And I'm glad that you're on your mission. It has been a pleasure having you here and talking with you. And one of my goals is to have an original piece of your art. So we will talk.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Okay. It's been a pleasure. If you would like more information about the University of the District of Columbia, our academic programs or services, please visit the university's website at www.udc.edu. If you would like to learn more about the University of the District of Columbia Community College, visit their website at www.cc.udc.edu. Thank you for watching. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber.